Xôm chương quý. Ông chung nguồn ra bạc cả bằng tó. Hay lấy ní xôm chương xạ bì nhá thư xà ra nà. Xôm chương.
Good afternoon, Your Honors. We will try to respond to the arguments the defense has made this afternoon and also later to address some issues that were raised yesterday. I would like to start with the most recent submissions by defense counsel in the oral argument regarding recharacterization of the offense. Counsel states that this would introduce a new element into the trial, where Your Honors to utilize joint criminal enterprise for the four crimes where the trial chamber did not enter convictions under joint criminal enterprise. She's told us repeatedly it would introduce a new element, but the accused on the defense has never identified what is the new element. Is it the fact that there was a plurality of persons who had the intent to commit crimes within the jurisdiction of this court? No. That we know was litigated extensively at trial and is found in the judgment. Was it that the accused Khmer had the intent that these crimes be committed? No, that was alleged in the closing order that was found in the judgment. I will come in a moment to question number four, what the word intent means. Is it the fact that these crimes happened, that people were disappeared without providing information to their families, that exterminations occurred during the first forced transfer and the second, and that political officials and officers were persecuted by the regime. No, all of this has been litigated, and the trial chamber has made findings on all of these issues. All of these points the defense had every opportunity and took every opportunity to litigate. This case is exactly very much on along the lines of the Stackage appeal judgment that counsel mentioned. In the Stackage appeal judgment, to be clear, what happened in that case is that the trial chamber civil law judges, and it happened to be, did not like the concept of joint and criminal enterprise, and introduced in the judgment at trial a mode of liability of co-perpetration, largely following the German model of Roxin and this concept of co-perpetration. Neither the prosecution nor Stackage appealed whether or not co-perpetration was a mode of liability at the ICTY. It was the appeals chamber that on its own asked the parties to address that question and then made its own finding that co-perpetration was not within the modes of liability from the statute of the ICTY, and then reanalyzed the findings of the trial chamber to find that all of the elements of joint criminal enterprise were met. So this is a case where the trial chamber made no findings about a joint criminal enterprise. But the factual findings that they did make about how, in this case, the mayor of the town, Stockage, worked together with the police, with the army, in a criminal enterprise to forcibly deport individuals from the municipality, resulting in mass crime from approximately 1,500 killings. All of these, they found, fit the elements of joint criminal enterprise and convicted him of various crimes under joint criminal enterprise. Now, the concept of joint criminal enterprise and how it's used in this case, I think, has been complicated, frankly, in the defense argument. I'd like to revisit it a bit.
in a somewhat simplified First, absolutely, the defense is correct. Joint Joint Enterprise, of course, requires that the objective or the means of those entering into the agreement that they have contemplate a crime within the statute of the tribunal. And in the case, in this case, to simplify, both the closing order and the findings of the chamber, what's clear is they said that there was a non-criminal ultimate objective, and that was this radical agrarian revolution, and that the members of the joint criminal enterprise, including, of course, Nun Chia and Khieu Samphan, the other top leaders, agreed, understood that they would use criminal means, crimes within the jurisdiction of this court, to accomplish that objective. Now, I'm simplifying it a bit because I'm taking out this intermediate step that the closing order put in and was followed by the trial chamber of the five policies, which examined all of this in more detail. But to simplify it, and it's absolutely clear, this is what the joint criminal enterprise boils down to: an intent to commit achieve a radical revolution, political revolution, not in itself a violation of international criminal law, but by means that were clearly criminal. And the evidence in this case and the findings of the trial chamber have shown that each of the accused made significant contributions to that enterprise. And I could go into that in some detail, but just very briefly, in regards to Khieu Samphan, what the trial chamber found is, in his own words, he played an important, if not essential, role in the Khmer Rouge development of their policies. He served, as we know, as in various positions that made him very prominent to the public, both to the Cambodian public and international. And this was in a regime where it was very secretive, so that in that amplified the importance of his role. He was seen by many people as the leader of the Khmer Rouge, because that's all they knew. Pol Pot and Nguyen Chia were staying in the shadows. And the trial chamber, the evidence shows, and the findings show, Khieu Samphan made very important contributions to that enterprise, particularly to these killings, both in his announcement, further announcements that the seven traitors would be killed. I think he added some names, including Long Nong, who was killed, to those who would be killed, with the threat that anyone who didn't join them in time would further suffer the same fate. Those who didn't defect before the victory of the Khmer Rouge would suffer the same fate. And in announcing many of the announcements he made during the evacuation, he was the person that was on the radio talking about when Long Nol, for example, fled, when the Americans pulled out. He was the person that was on the radio representing the Khmer Rouge. And when people were on the road being evacuated from Phnom Penh under horrendous conditions, inhumane conditions, Khieu Samphan remained the spokesperson, the voice justifying this, glorifying the great victory of the Khmer Rouge in capturing Phnom Penh, all the time that the regime that he was serving was inflicting this tremendous suffering upon the population. So the findings of the chamber clearly show both Nguyen Chia and Khieu Samphan made their significant contributions to this joint criminal enterprise, which clearly contemplated the use of criminal means to achieve their objective. I'd like to come to the question that Your Honors asked about intent. We all agree that the cases have said that those who are members of the joint criminal enterprise under the first form, the basic form of the joint criminal enterprise. In fact, for all forms, or also for the third form of the joint criminal enterprise, must intend to commit a crime within the jurisdiction of the court. The question is, what does the word intend mean? that if you look at general principles of criminal law across all legal systems, the word intent is never for general intent crimes. I'm not talking about specific intent crimes like genocide, but for general intent crimes, the word intent always includes committing intentional conduct with knowledge of the consequences that will occur, will probably occur. I'm hesitating because you see across different systems, different words used to express the concept that the person commits the intentional conduct, aware of the probability, the substantial likelihood, the fact that it will occur in the normal course of events, that it's natural and foreseeable. All these different words are used to express what it means to intend a crime. And in civil law, it's generally the general approach is to divide intent into three concepts. First, dolus directus of the first degree, that this is the object of your conduct. The object of your conduct is to kill this person. Second, dolus directus of the second degree, which we submit at a minimum is included in the joint criminal enterprise of the first degree, joint criminal enterprise, in meaning of intent. Dolus directus of the second degree expressed again in different systems in different countries in different languages in slightly different words, but it means that you're aware that this consequence is probable, substantial likelihood, natural and foreseeable, and will occur in the ordinary course of events. Different words are used for that. But it expresses the concept that you're aware that your conduct has a substantial likelihood of causing this consequence. In fact, we think the word substantial likelihood is the most appropriate. Remember, the word, the joint criminal enterprise in the tribunals, including this one, ICTY and ICTR, has been found by your honors in different courts, by the pretrial chamber here, trial chamber here, appeals chambers and other tribunals, to become under the statutes of those courts because it's part of committing. They say the word committing includes commission by joint criminal enterprise. So what is the intent required for committing? Well, again, it's been expressed slightly differently in different cases at the ICTY, but in Lucas versus Lucas, for example, the trial chamber held that, quote, this is paragraph 900, that the requisite mens rea for committing is that the accused acted with the intent to commit the crime or with an awareness of the probability in the sense of the substantial likelihood that the crime would occur as a consequence of his conduct. To give a very practical example, a person is trying to get away from the police and the traffic is slow in front of them, so they decide to go on the sidewalk to go faster, to get away from the police, knowing that there are people or likely to be people on the sidewalk. I think in any legal system where the person does that, even though they may hope, gee, I hope I don't hit anyone because it'll slow me down. Their objective is to get away from the police, not to hit people. But they're aware by driving them on the sidewalk, there's a substantial likelihood that they're going to hit and kill pedestrians. I think in every legal system, the person will be held responsible for that conduct. Now, one of the things that I felt the defense was conflating continually this afternoon and also in their appeal brief is the mens rea for joint criminal enterprise of the third, the extended form, JC3, with joint criminal enterprise in the first or in the second categories. The Contrary to what the defense is saying, substantial likelihood is not the standard for joint criminal enterprise in the third extended form. Joint criminal enterprise extended form is very, in my submission, very consistent with what is normally called dolus eventualis in the civil law system. If you look at the Krajicnik decision on this issue, there was a trial and appeal judgment decision, an interlocutory appeal.
Let's
see if I can find that. I hope I can come back to you with that later. But in that decision, Krajicnik made it clear that, it's Karadzic, it's not Krajicnik, it's the Karadzic decision. In the more recent case of Karadzic, the appeals chamber made it clear the defense was challenged whether or not the intent required mens rea for the third degree should be that the crime will probably occur or just possibly occur. And the appeals chamber made clear in Karadzic's decision that the standard is possible, but possible, and the accused must accept that risk, must reconcile himself with the risk. So that is what the extended form, the mens rea for the extended form of the amounts to. Now the evidence in this case, we submit and found by the trial chief, clearly shows that the killings, the forced transfers, all of the crimes, the extermination, the persecutions, all occurred in an extended pattern. And the accused had pre-knowledge of these events for many years for this pattern of conduct, continual knowledge of these crimes occurring, and continue to make their contributions to this joint criminal enterprise. So the evidence in the case, we submit, shows clearly that they had the intent, they were aware, we would say, the best words we would say to use for the intent required for the first form of joint criminal enterprise is substantial likelihood. But I don't see that as being different other than semantically in practice with cases that use the words knew that in the ordinary course of events the crimes would be committed. Recall, for future events, it's never possible to know with an absolute certainty that events will occur. We can only know that they're probable to various degrees of probability. Even the Eisengruppen case, this group of mass executioners that killed hundreds of thousands during the Nazi purges of minorities, Jews and other minorities. Yes, counsel read something where she said, she quoted language, which said they participated in it knowing the crime would occur. But of course, you never know for certain that, for example, the Allies won't rescue, won't achieve victory the next day and no one else will be killed. You may send a train load of victims of minorities, of Jews, Roma, to Auschwitz. You don't know if they for sure that they won't escape, that the war won't end before they are executed, or that they won't be one of the very few that are picked out to do labor instead of being killed. That hardly would mean that you don't intend their killing by your conduct. You do conduct aware of the substantial likelihood or that in the normal course of events these crimes will happen. And this is exactly what happened, what occurred with Khieu Samphan and Nguyen Chia, the killings at places like Chuan Co Tre. Of course, the trial chamber found they were not aware of every single killing around the country, and there wasn't clear evidence that they knew beforehand about the killing at Thul Po Tre, but it was part of a pattern of conduct that they endorsed and certainly knew about and contributed, and part of the joint criminal enterprise that they continued to contribute to. one clarification. Counts at one point said you must contribute to the crime and join the
Mafia.
That's not correct. You go to Tadic. Unlike motive liability such as aiding and abetting, where you have to show that the accused's contribution has a substantial effect on the crime. For joint criminal enterprise, you simply have to show that the accused made a substantial contribution
to the enterprise.
There's many other points to cover, but
because
time is limited,
I
also wanted to give an
opportunity
to my colleague, Mr. Lysak, to address you on some of the issues about the planning for the first force transfer, in particular, Khieu Samphan's role in the planning for the first force transfer, particularly since a lot of emphasis was put in the defense arguments on the testimony of Pi Phun, and he is the co-prosecutor who conducted that examination, so I turn it over to him at this point.
Good afternoon, Your Honors.
Som chamrib sua lok lok srei che krom.
I'm happy to take this opportunity to address what I think is probably the most central issue that is raised by the defense and what you've heard so far in these appeal hearings. We've heard a lot of accusations that the trial chamber is distorting the evidence, that this was not a real trial, a show trial. What I would like to do with you in this time that I have is to show you that this was about the evidence. Khieu Samphan was not convicted because of some bias at the trial chamber held. Khieu Samphan was convicted based on very clear evidence of his contribution to a common criminal plan. And specifically, what I want to talk about are the two meetings that counsel, Khieu Samphan's counsel made reference to yesterday, the two key meetings at which decisions were made by the Khmer Rouge leaders to evacuate all the residents of Phnom Penh. The first was a meeting that was held in mid-1974, June to July time period. But that is the meeting that Nun Chea, at the very start of this trial, described in detail in a statement he gave and on which he was subsequently examined while he was testifying. It's a meeting that is referenced in some of the revolutionary flags and contemporary documents. And Nun Chea describes what took place at that meeting and the initial decision made at that time that when Phnom Penh was captured, the entire population would be evacuated with no exceptions, no exceptions for the sick or elderly. Everyone had to go. The issue that Pi Phun brought to this meeting, Pi Phun testified that Khieu Samphan was one of the leaders who was present at that meeting. And this became a central issue of disputed by the defense and by Khieu Samphan's wife.
ក៏ដូចជាដោយប
Mungle the pronunciation of this case. It is the Kajela Jelly appeal judgment, ICTR 98-44A-A. And specifically, paragraphs 59-61 of that decision contain some very detailed discussion of what is required from a trial chamber in this situation. I quote from paragraph 59. The appeals chamber is mindful of the position expressed in the Massima appeal judgment that a trial chamber is not required to set out in detail why it accepted or rejected a particular testimony. And that is some discussion of the general law about the task of weighing and assessing credibility of witnesses dealing with the trial chamber. Under some circumstances, a reasoned explanation of the trial chamber's assessment of a particular witness's credibility is a crucial component of the reasoned opinion. For instance, where there is a genuine and significant dispute surrounding a witness's credibility,
Paragraph 139.
Was that given the contradictions in so Sajid's testimony, her motivation to assist her husband
Credibility of witnesses being a matter of trier of fact. You would have had to be here for his testimony and the testimony of almost all the others to understand how different Peapon was from many of the other Khmer Rouge cadres who came to testify in this court. He was clear and straightforward. He was direct. Unlike many who came in and were evasive, denied the positions they held in the regime, were evasive in answering questions to the point that they had, you had to drag the information out of them, which we did. He answered the questions. His memory was extremely good. He was a breath of fresh air in this court, and he was extremely credible. And that is why you heard the defense go on the attack against him yesterday when we were to be discussing issues relating to fair trial rights. Why did the trial chamber accept Peapon's testimony about Khieu Samphan being present at that meeting? Because it was brought to light
Because they heard from another witness, Sun Sikun, who was with Khieu Samphan and Ing Sari on a trip they were taking abroad about the timing of their return to Cambodia. Specifically, that they came back to Hanoi at the end of May 1974. They then went down to make a visit to Laos, to the liberated zone in South Vietnam, and by early or mid-June, Khieu Samphan and Ing Sari were on their way back into the country. There's an issue that I will not get into right now about some contemporaneous telegrams. If you have questions about that, I'm happy to get into that, but I will leave that aside. But there are also contemporaneous diplomatic cables establishing the timing.
Second reason,
the testimony of Khieu Samphan's wife. What she ultimately testified, and let me refer your honors specifically to testimony on the 10th of June 2013, which took place at 1540 to 1516. She testified that their first child was born on the 4th of May 1974, and that around that time they had to move to the Meek office. It was a new office, and I went there during my early days after giving birth. Then, question, at the time when you had your first baby, was Mr. Khieu Samphan with you, that is on the day of the delivery of the baby? Answer, during that time when I gave birth to my first child, he was in China, and about a month later, he returned. We remained together and went to the Meek office.
End quote.
So, while Sochit came here to try to give an alibi to her husband, because she testified that when Khieu Samphan came back from meetings where he was negotiating deals with China and Vietnam to support the Khmer Rouge, she claimed that he then spent 2 months staying at home, changing naps. That's the exact words that she used. Now, the trial chamber did not find this credible. More important about her testimony, though, she puts Khieu Samphan back in Cambodia in June 1974, the time of these meetings. And she puts him at the location where the meetings took place. These meetings took place at Meek. When you look at Sochit's testimony, she puts herself and Khieu Samphan at the very location where these meetings took place. I also mentioned Ing Sari made an admission in an interview with Steve Petter that he returned in 1974 to the country and discussed at a meeting with Pol Pot the evacuation. This was also relied on by the trial chamber. I go through this in detail because it has been repeatedly said here that the case has not been decided upon the evidence, and that could not be further from the truth. For us, this has always been about the evidence. Everything that went on in this courtroom for almost 2 years, October 2011 till the trial was finished in 2013, was about the evidence. It was very important to us that the evidence be presented accurately, fairly, that the defendants have a chance to confront that evidence, and that the convictions, that the judgment be evaluated and decided based on the evidence. And we take extreme issue
with the rhetoric we've heard so far in this hearing.
The second meeting, which in some ways is even more important,
that people testified to,
was a meeting in early April 1975, held at an office called B5.
And
B5 was the central command headquarters of the Khmer Rouge leaders, an office established by Pol Pot, where he met with the military commanders from the various zones and commanded the attack on Phnom Penh. Peepon was there because he again was working as Pol Pot's guard. And he testified that a meeting was held about 2 weeks before 17 April to finalize the plans for the evacuation. He described in detail where the meeting took place, the time of day. And he testified that both Nunchea and Thi Somphon were there, that they both expressed their positions, and they both agreed the plan to evacuate Phnom Penh. Again, the trial chamber looked to see if there was corroborating evidence to support Peepon's testimony. And there was, because both Nunchea and Khieu Somphon admitted, given statements that they were at that location in the weeks preceding 17 April 1975. And indeed, there is actually film footage This is the type of detail that we heard in this courtroom. Final confirmation, a July 1982 interview of Khieu Somphon reported by the New York Times, document E3-687. This is what Khieu Somphon said to the New York Times in 1982. This is the reporter's words. He, referring to Khieu Somphon, acknowledged that millions of Cambodians had been sent out of Phnom Penh and into the countryside as a result of a collective decision. Had he joined in the decision? As Khieu Somphon said himself, if there had been a single vote against the evacuations, there could have been no evacuations. That is the collective decision principle that Your Honors are, I'm sure, aware of. Your Honors, the evidence about Khieu Somphon's contribution wasn't just limited to his attending those meetings. And Peepun also testified that Khieu Samphon was one of the cadres along with Pol Pot and Nguyen Chia, who conducted presentations to the cadres to explain why the evacuation was necessary and relied on the experiences from other cities they had captured, such as Udong. This is the evidence upon which Khieu Samphan was convicted. Compelling detailed testimony about his approval and contribution to a criminal plan to forcibly evacuate the population of Phnom Penh, corroborated by multiple sources, not civil party applications. The one other issue I want to talk about today is the issue that council have raised as to whether the zone, whether the armies were independent, autonomous zone armies, or whether, in fact, they were subject to central authority. You heard some quotes from Philip Short, expert from both the International Co-Prosecutor and from Khieu Samphan's counsel. But there was much, much more evidence from the people who were directly involved in this, from the people who were at these command headquarters. That is the dispositive evidence, I believe, when we look at this issue. And specifically, we heard from four or five witnesses about the two command headquarters operated by Pol Pot, Nguyen Chia, I heard a quote read suggesting that there was problems with communications, but we heard from multiple witnesses who were actually involved in the telegram offices in that time period, the war time period. Norn Sofang testified on the 29th of August 2012 at 14:38 to 14:42
He described how he received his telegram from Khmer to the CPC's telegram in 73 and 42 that went zone for hours around the country just battles.
Peepun also testified that while he was at P5, he delivered messages between Khieu Samphan and the battlefield. This is on the 2nd of August 2012 at 9:12 to 9:15. Numerous witnesses testified that the zone commanders coming from the regular meetings to obtain instructions. And I would specifically direct your honors by way of corroboration of what we heard from the witnesses in this court to an interview that was given by Kai Pak before his death. Kai Pak was at the time of the war the deputy secretary of the North Zone. He was one of the military commanders overseeing troops in the war, and he later became the secretary of the North, the Central Zone. His interview is E3/2782. And you will find in that interview a very detailed account of the battles during 1970-75 and the orders that he received directly from the Central Committee to Son Sen about the attack where they tried to capture Kampong Cham and take the people out of there. There is simply no question on the evidence heard in this courtroom that this was a centrally commanded military operation. Your Honors, I could address you for length about the evidence in these proceedings. All we ask is that when you reach your decision, it's based on the transcripts, the documents, the evidence that we worked very hard to put before the trial chamber for almost 2 years. We simply cannot decide this based on rhetorical arguments that this was a show trial. I'm happy during the time I'm here to answer whatever questions you may have. As someone who was there in the trial, I have a little more familiarity with the record. I have an understanding of the difficulty of the task.
រួមទាំងមានតវិកាពីក្តីផងថាយើងនឹងព្យាយាមធ្វើតាមដែលយើងអាចធ្វើទៅបានហើយនឹងឆ្លើយទៅនឹងសំណួរនានាដល់ជំនះអង្គជំនុំជម្រះមាន
One. I was allowed one question by the President.
Council,
if could you, at least in a sketchy form, help us however connect the alleged or contentious presence of Khieu Samphan at meetings which you described with his knowledge of extermination or murders that occurred during the evacuation of Phnom Penh. We are aware that there is an evidence that in the meeting the second meeting that at B5, there was a success of Udong evacuation discussed, but we understand from the evidence of the same witness it had gone smoothly.
The B5 meeting wouldn't on itself necessarily show that a sinister
or more sinister than the evacuation
And hence, your vision is broader than the evacuation.
So if you could help with this, I'd appreciate it. If not, we will wait with our questions for tomorrow's session.
Thank you, Your Honor. I don't have my notes immediately handy on the dong, and I want I wouldn't exactly describe people's testimony as the evacuation of Udong went smoothly, that was not an event. It was successful, but you have to look at the details of what actually took place when Udong was evacuated. And what happened when Steve Hitler found out what happened when Steve Hitler found out people were not just likely to flee. They would take out all the people they would kill communists, and they would burn the house. Steve Hedder made it to Udong. Evidence that things were confirmed.
These were isolated, the same thing happened when they took the place for example.
ຈັ່ງສົມອໍຄຸນໃຫ້ປີນີ້ຄືຍັງບານດອລເປວລຽນຶງສໍາຣະໃຫ້ໃນថ្ងៃນີ້ໂດຍຊິຂ້ອຍສົມປະກາດ peel sai mun maung 9 prak tala ka prakas samrak